As the Archabbot and Chancellor, and also on behalf of Brother Norman, the President of St. Vincent College, and Father Ed Mazik, the Rector of St. Vincent Seminary, I extend a warm welcome to all of you to this evening presentation of Threshold, the Rabbi Edelstein Lecture in commemoration of the 80th anniversary of Kristallnacht, a night of broken glass. I want to take this moment to express my gratitude to Rabbi Edelstein, to his son Joe, and to all of their family for the establishment of this wonderful lecture in honor of Rabbi Edelstein, who has been a member of the St. Vincent faculty now for nearly 50 years, and certainly an important part of the Benedictine family here at St. Vincent. And Rabbi, would you please? I also want to say a special word of thanks to Rabbi Ron Symons, who is our presenter this evening, for his presence and also for his friendship to the entire Pittsburgh community, and thanks for being here with us this evening. A special welcome also to Mary Burkett, who's many of you had the opportunity to see the drawings which are on the first floor of this building. They will be on exhibition here till November 20th, this evening to November 20th. So if you haven't seen them this evening, please take an advantage. It's called Beloved Children of the Holocaust, and they're wonderful portraits of the young children who died during the Holocaust. A special word of welcome also to Joanne Rogers, the wife of the late Fred Rogers. This is the 50th anniversary of Fred Rogers and children's television, and certainly it's had a profound impact on the lives of all of us, and we're grateful for her presence here this evening. And it's appropriate that this takes place in the Fred Rogers Center, this event. We know that Fred Rogers has been an important part of this community here in Latrobe, where he was born, and part of the Pittsburgh community for many years, and really in many ways is a spiritual father for the nation and for the world, the many lives that he touched over these many years. The sad events of this past week at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh remind us all that anti-Semitism continues and that the solution requires the active participation of each one of us. Again, it's fitting that this takes place in the Fred Rogers Center. The theme of Mr. Rogers over his many, many years was, "Won't you be my neighbor?" And like Fred Rogers, Rabbi Symons reminds us that it's important for all of us to join in redefining neighbor from a geographic term into a moral imperative. And we're looking forward, Rabbi, to your presentation this evening. We begin this evening with a special remembrance of the victims of those who were killed in the shootings at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh. We remember in a special way their family and friends, their children, parents, loved ones, who also mourn their loss. We also remember the police officers and the first responders who were there that day with them to help them through that tragic event. Let us now bow our heads as we remember the departed.
Oh.
Let us now bow our heads as we remember Rose Mellinger, Joyce Feinberg, Irving Younger, Melvin Wax, Cecil Rosenthal, David Rosenthal, Daniel Stein, Jerry Rabinowitz, Bernice Simon, Sylvia Simon, Richard Gottfried. O God, full of compassion, who dwells on high, grant true rest upon the wings of divine presence in the exalted spheres of the holy and pure, who shine as the resplendence of the firmament on the souls of our recently departed brothers and sisters at the Tree of Life Synagogue. May the All-Merciful One shelter them with the cover of his wings forever and bind their souls in the bond of life. The Lord is their heritage. May they rest in his resting place in peace. And let us say, Amen. And I'd like to call on Dr. Patricia Charbaugh to introduce our speaker.
Love your neighbor as yourself. It is a simple commandment, and yet we know how difficult this commandment is to keep. We gather this evening for an event planned many months ago. Who would have thought that an event at the Fred Rogers Center, planned to commemorate the 80th anniversary of Kristallnacht, would take place so near in time and place to a murderous attack on the Jewish people in a synagogue in our neighborhood, in the neighborhood of Fred Rogers. Our lecture this evening extends the scope of the Rabbi Jason Edelstein Chair for Catholic-Jewish Dialogue Beyond the Classroom. St. Vincent College established the chair to recognize the contribution Rabbi Edelstein has made to Catholic-Jewish dialogue through his teaching on our faculty for 50 years. A saying of the Siddur reads, "A religion is best known by the lives that express it." The kind and thoughtful presence of Rabbi Edelstein for so many years has helped not only our students, but all of us at St. Vincent to understand the Jewish biblical tradition more deeply. Upon learning of the establishment of the Chair for Catholic-Jewish Dialogue, Rabbi Edelstein's son, Joseph, made an initial gift to help the college extend the impact of the Chair beyond the classroom in events such as our lecture this evening. In November 2016, we had a symposium of three Jewish scholars and three Catholic scholars to explore the meaning of the biblical teaching that humans are created in the divine image. I personally have benefited substantially from Catholic-Jewish dialogue with Rabbi Edelstein. This spring semester will be the fourth time Rabbi Edelstein and I will co-teach a course called Catholic-Jewish Dialogue. Every time I teach this course, I learn more of the Jewish tradition from Rabbi Edelstein. This learning deepens my own Catholic faith. One of the highlights of the course is when we travel to Temple David and attend a Friday evening Shabbat service. I feel close to God when I am praying with the Jewish people at Temple David. I sense the deep connection between our faith traditions. I experience the truth that we are brothers and sisters in faith. I have been formed, shaped, and learned so much through my participation in Catholic-Jewish dialogue that it is an integral aspect of every class I teach. Rabbi Ron Symons serves as the Senior Director of Jewish Life at the Jewish Community Center of Greater Pittsburgh. He is responsible for guiding the Center of Loving Kindness and Civic Engagement of the JCC, through which the JCC and its partners redefine neighbor from a geographic term into a moral concept. We are honored to have him with us tonight and look forward to hearing his lecture on loving your neighbor as yourself, 21st century imperatives. Rabbi Symons, welcome.
I'm so grateful and humbled to be here. Let me begin with perhaps the mundane, but I believe the sacred obligation. You see that I'm wearing my button that says that I voted today. If you have not voted yet, You still have, I think, 43 minutes. You're welcome to stand up now and to go vote. Let me also offer my thanks to the Archabbot and to the administration of St. Vincent's, including the president. I'm particularly touched that as we remember those who died just 9 days ago, that the words that the Archabbot chose to share towards the end of the memorializing were the words of the El Malei Rachamim prayer, the memorial prayer that is recited across the Jewish community at funerals and on the anniversary of someone's death. I'm grateful for that incredible sensitivity and that we can share liturgy in that way. I'm also grateful to Rabbi Edelstein, a rabbi's rabbi. So I have a very unique relationship with the rabbi. You see, I am not his successor. I am the husband of his successor at Temple David. My wife now occupies the pulpit that he established. And I get to sit about 14 rows back in my seat in the sanctuary among the generations of Jews of the eastern suburbs who have been inspired by the rabbinic leadership at Temple David, and I'm grateful that we can be together now. Thank you, Rabbi. There is something eternally contemporary about the words that we're going to share tonight, the conversation that we're going to have, and I truly hope that it is a conversation. As was mentioned, we planned this over the summer, and who knew? Who knew that two Saturdays ago, as I was planning to go to the South Hills of Pittsburgh to St. Paul's Church for an interfaith conference on the environment, and the night before having realized that I left my papers at the JCC, that I would make a left turn from Braddock Avenue onto Forbes Avenue at approximately 9:52. And that there would be police cars, one after another, slowly from behind me, and I would pull over to let them pass. And then as I got to Shady Cross Street, and then to Murray, the other cross street, that police cars and ambulances would be zipping by. And I thought, boy, there's something big. And it was only moments later that when I pulled into the JCC that people already knew that something had happened. And we sprung into action. We sprung into action as a crisis center in order to support victims and community members, to support the FBI, the police, the county, the Red Cross, a whole array of different organizations who, as of yesterday, began to leave. So now comes the hard work, right? When the media leaves and everyone else that was here leaves. I will say that over the course of last week, I felt overwhelmed, awash with grief. I know several of the people who died rather well. In fact, Irv Younger and I had a debate the Friday before last, the day before he died, about the Allegheny County referendum on the kids' campaign to establish a kids' fund. Irv was of the opinion, I don't think he would mind me sharing this, that no one should pay taxes. Everyone's on their own. And I said, Irv, come on, we're all in this together. We went back and forth. We were in a group of around 40 people. He often dominated the space. And then when we were all done, it was a Friday morning, and I handed him a piece of challah, bread for the Sabbath. I smiled at him. I shook his hand. I said, Irv, I always love arguing with you. During the course of that first week, I was overwashed, overwhelmed with grief. And slowly, I've been washed with compassion and love and caring from all around, from people you would never expect. And I'm beginning to turn my thoughts and my intentions, as many of us are, to how is it that we can make sense out of this, and how can we help people to thrive again. And so I'm hopeful that in our time together now, as we look back 80 years ago to start with, and then look forward, look to today and forward into tomorrow, that we too can find a sense of compassion and warmth as we figure out how do we make sense of all of this. My hope is that as we make our way through, that we might actually have a conversation, not to leave the conversation until the very end, but that perhaps we can talk as we make our way through. But let's just make sure that we're all on the same page around Kristallnacht. It was November 9th, 1938. In the space of a few hours, thousands of synagogues and Jewish businesses and homes were damaged or destroyed. 91 Jews were killed, and others were injured, and it was the beginning of the deportations. And it signaled the beginning of the end, the final solution. This picture in Zeven, Germany, you'll see in the forefront, well, maybe you can begin to identify, what do you see there? Can you pick out anything that's in that picture?
A scroll.
I see lampstands, right? I'll point a little bit, let's see if this works. There we go, the lampstands. Over there, sorry, I'm not on that side, right? I'll move, right? I see chairs, right? I see images that, if they were turned the right way, would be images that you would see in a synagogue, the ritual items of a synagogue. And what do you see in the background? Children, right? What are they doing there? They're watching. And there's a guard there. Why do you think they're watching? What was that?
Their parents have gone?
I'm not sure that they're Jewish children. I think that they're children in the community. And I think a part of this was to bear witness to what was about to come. And I think to myself, gee, looking at that picture, how sad. How sad that the next generation not only has to experience the devastation at the hands of the government, but the next generation is lined up to watch and witness it in person. A searing memory that they probably will never forget. And I think I look at that image where there are people looking at devastation, looking at horrific events, and it takes me to this image. The original sin of America. That we would look at certain people, residents, citizens, and say they're lesser than us, they're others, they're dehumanized. When the time comes to lynch them, we'll all stand around and watch. Over the course of this past week, people have said to me, it's like the Nazis all over again, and I say, no, it's not. Because when you look at the first image, the devastation was caused by the government. And when you think about what happened in the aftermath of the anti-Semitic terrorist attack, it was the government who were the first responders. The government is here to protect us, not just the Jews, us collectively. They're the ones that put themselves in harm's way so that more people would not be killed. And back in Germany, children get lined up in order to witness the devastation and what's going to come next. My guess is a bonfire. In America, back in the day, people line up to witness, here's what we do to those black folks. But 9 days ago, this is how people gathered. It's the corner of Forbes and Murray. In the upper right-hand corner is Cold Stone Creamery. In the upper left-hand corner is the library. The JCC is in the lower right-hand corner, but you just can't see it. Thousands of people came out and said, we're going to bring light into the darkness. We're going to reclaim the streets because we are neighbors. That intersection that I either drive on or walk on every single day, I live in Monroeville, I work at the JCC, is never ever going to be the same for me. After all, it's Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. Let's sing. I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? I'm looking at the words, but I probably don't need to. Because Joanne, as I described to you once before when we met at a bar mitzvah, I lived on East 56th Street in Brooklyn until I was 5 years old. And every day, I was born in 67. When did the neighborhood start?
68.
68. It was made for me. Look at that. Every day, I would walk from my house five houses down to Gloria's house. Gloria was the chairperson of the social studies department at Bushwick High School, where my dad was a teacher, and subsequently a lifelong friend. I would march down, she would sit me in front of the TV with carrot sticks, and I learned at the feet of Mr. Rogers. So it's inbred in all of us, this concept of neighbor. And I picked this image in particular, and Joanne told me that the image is from a woman who is working with children on the border now. I picked it because that intersection of Forbes and Murray, it's not going to be the same because of what's happened there. And I just want to bring a little bit of my experience to it. So the first funeral that we had was for Dr. Jerry Rabinowitz, another dear friend of mine and Alan's, I'm sure others in the room. And we came out of the JCC. We normally don't do funerals at the JCC. And all of a sudden, I saw in front of the hearse, or right near the hearse, that there were about 50 or 60 or so Orthodox Jews. Keep in mind, I'm a Reformed Jew. I'm liberal. Orthodox Jews tend to have bigger beards, darker kippot and the like, right? They dress more conservatively. I said, what are you doing? They said, we're walking behind the hearse. Did you make arrangements for that? I said, what? They said, did you tell the police that we're going to walk? I said, no, but I will. And I thought that I would need to go back into the building to tend to some other matters, but as I saw them beginning to walk, I couldn't stop. And I walked with them. I made a left on Murray, a right on Forbes, and then we went up about a mile to Homewood Cemetery. And I realized as I was walking that it's the neighborhood. Everybody stopped. It wasn't just a funeral for the Jewish community. It wasn't just a funeral for the family and those who knew Jerry. It wasn't just a funeral for the 100 cars that were processing. People stopped with their hands on their hearts. They stopped as they were sobbing. We reclaimed the streets of Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. And that was the first moment, well, the second moment of uplift for me during the week. I'll tell you about the first one in a little bit. So as we move now forward into our question of love your neighbor, let's consider a few questions about it and see how it is that these lessons can help us to make our way through. So I'm curious, what does the phrase love your neighbor conjure up for you? What do you think its origins are? Where do we find it? And how do we live it? So I am more than happy to have someone pick any one of those questions and tell us, what do you think? Anyone have an answer or reflection on one of those questions? What's it mean to you? Well, I'm going to come out. I'm going to be Phil Donahue now. It's the same era. Who said that? Here we go.
Be kind to everyone.
Be kind to everyone. Great. Let's keep on yelling out things. Yeah. Nice and loud.
One of the answers when a man asks Christ what the greatest commandment.
Oh, so it comes from religious teachings. When someone said to Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? He said, now, mind you, I'm about to quote Christian Bible at St. Vincent's. And I don't know about you, Rabbi, if you've ever done that, but I feel very intimidated right now. So the answer was, watch this.
Deuteronomy.
Well, let's start with the New Testament, with the Christian Bible. What was Jesus' answer when he said, what is the greatest commandment?
Love your neighbor. Well, love the Lord your God with all your soul, all your strength, with all your mind.
So Jesus responded, both love your neighbor and love the Lord, right? And you began to give away a little bit of it. It goes back to Deuteronomy, right? Jesus was drawing on long-standing Torah traditions, right? And those have been amplified because of his life, his work, and the work of generations that have come since. So what I'm particularly interested in is how do we first understand to whom does this sentence belong? Ve'ahavta l'reyecha kamocha ani Adonai. Love your neighbor as yourself. I am Adonai. I use the word Adonai. It is the common word that we use in Hebrew to speak about God in his most intimate way. It is, for those of you who have done a little biblical scholarship, it is the tetragrammaton, the four-letter name of God that is unpronounceable. Adonai actually means my master. It's our common liturgical way of speaking about God. So it belongs to both of us. It is both Jewish and Christian. We're going to read a little bit now from Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks, the chief rabbi of England. He writes in Covenant and Conversation, one text in the Torah is famous above all others, the phrase from this weekly portion that he's talking about in the book of Leviticus, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. This, said Rabbi Akiva, who lived in the first century just after Jesus, it is the great principle of the Torah. The rule of justice is common in moral codes. The first moral judgment a child tends to make is, it's not fair. Justice as fairness is common. What is distinctly uncommon is the idea born in Judaism and adopted by Christianity that love is the central virtue of a moral life. But we already knew that love is the beginning of everything. He goes on to say, it's remarkable how rarely this simple truth has been acknowledged. And now a little bit of truth-telling. For many centuries, Christians taught that the God of the Old Testament was a God of love and of law and retribution, while the God of the New Testament was a God of love and forgiveness, despite the fact that Christians believed him to be the same God. Whenever love your neighbor is mentioned in the New Testament, it is always explicitly a quotation from the Torah. I believe it goes something like this, the law states, correct? Right? Yet to this day, if you look up or encounter the quote, love your neighbor as yourself, more often than not, you'll find it attributed in the New Testament. Indeed, Leviticus 19 teaches us also a third love. In addition to that of God and our neighbor, he's British, so you see he writes neighbor weird, right? If a stranger dwells with you in your land, you shall not mistreat him. The stranger who dwells among you shall be to you as one born among you, and you shall love him as yourself. For you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. By the way, that commandment to love the stranger, to be kind to the stranger, is repeated 36 times in the Torah. 36 times. Just to give you a sense, laws about keeping kosher, like not mixing milk and meat together, which you know is one of the big things about kosher, maybe it gets 3 or 4 mentions. This is gigantic. This is the ultimate core of why it is that we treat strangers as human beings in need of help, in need of compassion, in need of humanity, because we were strangers in the land of Egypt. He goes on to say it's easy to love your neighbor as yourself because throughout most of history, your neighbors were often like yourself. After all, we lived in closed societies. In culture and class and nationality and ethnicity, the challenge now is as we live in this broad, open society, how do we look at others and understand that they are not an other, but they are us? How do we see the humanity in each other and act accordingly? If you look at the full quote from Leviticus, it begins, "Do not hate your brother in your heart. You must admonish your neighbor and not bear sin because of him. Do not take revenge nor bear a grudge against the children of your people. You must love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." It's not just love, but you'll see that what Rabbi Sacks says is that what we need to do is to appreciate that it sometimes doesn't begin with love. That sometimes there are people out there who just rub us the wrong way. And we need to go from them rubbing us the wrong way to understanding that they need to be loved the way that we want to be loved. So that gives us a bit of the background of the text, an understanding that it is ours. Has its origins in the Hebrew Bible, is continued to be amplified in the Christian Bible, and then what we'll see now is throughout history, it has been explained and explained in ways that really can engage us in 21st century southwestern Pennsylvania. So I wonder, is it trite? No, I know that that's a throwaway question. I can tell you that over the course of the past year, as we've been developing the Center for Loving Kindness and Civic Engagement, which you'll see is based on love your neighbor as yourself and do not stand idle while your neighbor bleeds, no one has said to me, "Oh, come on, Ron. Why are you focusing on those commandments, on those values? They're so pedestrian." No, no, no. They're foundational. They're basic. It's what we need to be doing. And so let's get a look in the 10th century. A midrash says that this is what the Holy One said to Israel. "My children, what do I seek of you? I seek no more than you love one another and honor one another." If you had to boil it all down, that's the basics. Religion is intended to help us to figure out how do we get along with one another in sacred relationship through God. And of course, us Jews, we don't have a corner on that market. Mr. Rogers taught us it too. He said that every human being has value. This is the basis of all healthy relationships. "Through living each day as it is given to me, I've learned that it cannot be taught, but it can be caught from those who live their lives right along with us. What a privilege to be able to look for the good in our neighbor." Love your neighbor as yourself is an opportunity to actually learn something from someone else that you would not have been experiencing if you considered them to be an other, as opposed to a part of you. So what is that foundation of our connectivity to one another? Why is it that we need to interact with one another? What is it about us that is so similar? So now, from the Eitz Chaim Torah commentary, by the way, this is the Torah commentary that was in Tree of Life. It's the one that they use. Not this actual book, but it's the version. And by the way, the words Eitz Chaim mean Tree of Life. They quote Buber, Martin Buber, understood this commandment as being connected to the preceding one, you shall not take vengeance, because all human beings are a part of the same body. To hurt another person is an effort to get even, is an effort to get even, is to hurt part of oneself. So when I read that about the body, the part of the same body, I thought, gee, that sounds, it sounds like it has more of a home in a Christian place than in a Jewish place. And I like it. It's a reminder that we're all connected. He compares it to a person whose hand slips while holding a knife, and he stabs himself. Should he stab the offending hand that slipped to get even with it for hurting him? He'll only hurt himself a second time. So it is when we, in anger, hurt another person, not understanding that we are all connected. Anger and a thirst for vengeance corrode the soul. Love your neighbor as yourself is an admonishment to say that even if someone has hurt you, don't immediately turn and hurt them back. Allow love, allow the way that you want to be treated to guide the way that you treat that person. And once again, let's bring Mr. Rogers into the conversation. The more I think about it, oh my, I love this one. The more I wonder if God and neighbor are somehow one. Loving God, loving neighbor, the same thing. For me, coming to recognize that God loves every neighbor is the ultimate appreciation. So let's actually stop for a moment. We won't advance more on the slides. I'm curious, what do you think about that concept? That loving God and loving neighbor might very well be one. Anyone have a thought on it? So that image, I'm aware that the image is a moral image. When it says in Genesis, B'tzelem Elohim, Baralto, in the image of God, Jewish wisdom has taught for generations that it's not a physical image, but it's that our capacity to make decisions for good, for ourselves and for others. Other thoughts about it, about the connection between love of God and love of other. That love of neighbor and love of God are actually the same thing.
My thought is that loving our neighbor is how we show we love God.
So it's a methodology to it. That we could spend, and many of us do, spend lots of time in prayer and reflection and study, but the rubber hits the road when we take those lessons, the lessons that we learn in sanctuaries and in study halls, and we actually apply them outside. I appreciate that. Anyone else? Yeah.
I go back to the quote from Liz, to love another person.
Is to see the face of God, Beautiful. And whenever I see that, I love Les Mis, right, by the way. And whenever I watch and I hear that line, I can't help but to think back to Jacob and Esau. You might remember Jacob and Esau, they were brothers who did not get along very well. And in fact, they needed to be separated for 20 years because of their animosity for one another. Jacob stole, was given, something like that, the blessing from Father Isaac. And Esau said, "You just wait till Dad dies, and I'm going to kill you, you son of a..." Right? So Jacob runs off. He marries two women, has children also with concubines. When his son, Joseph, his favorite son, is born, the rabbis tell us that Joseph came out of the womb looking exactly like Jacob. And it was at that moment that he knew that he needed to go back home. Now I look at that and I say, wait a second. If Joseph looked exactly like Jacob, Joseph also looked like Esau, because Jacob and Esau were twins. He saw in his next generation the mistakes that he had made with his brother. And then finally, when he gets back to his brother after the night of wrestling, he looks at him and he says, "To see your face is to see the face of God." And they named the place Peniel. Panim, panum is face, El is God, the face of God. When we look soulfully and intently at someone with the intent of having them be true and real, and we are true and real with them, we're in the presence of God. God is the sticky stuff between us that connects us to past generations and future generations and to one another. Let's take another look. So we began this one. What's the greatest commandment? We already answered that question. And so Rabbi Akiva said that you shall love your neighbor as yourself is a great principle, klal gadol, batorah, in the Torah. And Ben Azai said, no. This is the book of the descendants of Adam, him who God made in his likeness, going back to Genesis chapter 5, utters a principle even greater. You must not say, "Since I have been humiliated, let my fellow man also be humiliated. Since I have been cursed, let my neighbor also be cursed." For as Rabbi Tanhuma pointed out, if you act thus, realize who it is that you are willing to have humiliated. Him who God made in his likeness. We were created in the image of God. The issue is not love your neighbor as yourself, according to Azai and Tanhuma. The issue is that all of us are a part of this masterful creation and that God is in each one of us. And Mr. Rogers knew it too. As human beings, our job in life is to help people realize how rare and valuable each one of us really is. That each one of us has something that no one else has or ever will have. Something inside that is unique to all time. It's our job to encourage each other to discover that uniqueness and to provide ways of developing its expression. Love your neighbor, appreciating that we're all created in God's image, is our way of celebrating God in our manifested world. And how much do we have to give? Well, love for another equals love for self. This is from Nachmanides in the 13th century. He says, it's hyperbole. One can't literally be commanded to feel the same love for someone else as one does for oneself. I mean, how is that possible? Right? Because, we've known ourselves longer than we've known anybody else. In practical terms, Rabbi Akiva, we talked about him before, has already taught us that if only one life can be saved, You should save your own life at the expense of another person's. Now, we can spend a half hour just on that. But we won't. We'll just understand that Akiva says that if you own the water, it's yours. You should help someone else, but not necessarily at the expense of your own life. And I know that we can take current events and engage in that conversation. Let's just leave it for now. What the Torah is commanding, Nachmanides says, is that in practical terms, one should treat the other person in every respect, just as one would wish to be treated. And so you see here that he says, but it may be significant that the text, both here and in verse 34, does not literally say, love your fellow as yourself. But he adds the preposition that the English translations have not included, love for your fellow. So look at the Hebrew up on the top. You see that lightning bolt? That's a lamed. It's the Hebrew letter L. I've enlarged it simply to show you that the word bi'ahavta before it, oh, by the way, Hebrew begins from the right and goes to the left, right? Bi'ahavta on the right means you shall love. By the way, it's the same word that we use in the Shema and the Vi'ahavta. Vi'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your being. It's the same exact word. Love to your friend, your neighbor, like you. I am God. This would have to be explained as meaning that one's love for others should be equivalent to one's love for oneself. For sometimes a person might love another in some respects, but not in all. Let's admit it, we all know that we love people, and there are attributes of them that we kind of say, well, we could do something better. Treating him well, for example, with regard to money matters, but not to intellectual ones. If he loved him completely, he would want him to have wealth and property, honor, knowledge, and wisdom, but it actually is human nature that he'll always want more of them for himself. The text commands that one should not nurture these petty jealousies, but love one's fellow with the same unlimited love that one has for oneself. Don't nurture the desire for myself, but try to be as generous as possible, as engaging as possible. Show that love to that person, to that neighbor. And Fred says, all of us at some time or another need help. Whether we're giving or receiving help, each one of us has something valuable to bring to this world. That's one of the things that connects us as neighbors. In our own way, each one of us is a giver and a receiver. And so that takes me to October 29th. Don't mind me, I'm just checking our time. October 29th was Monday night. It was a Monday night, a week ago yesterday. I have taken upon myself the sacred responsibility of helping to prepare the dead for burial, according to Jewish tradition. There's a group of us that do this. I happened to come late on Monday night for the sacred work that we needed to do, knowing that I could step in with the team later in the night because we had to do this for several people. And all of a sudden, as I was preparing to go into the room, I was in an anteroom that had a door to the outside, and there was a very aggressive knock on the outside door. I said, "Who is it?" And a woman's voice said, "Don't worry, I'm not going to hurt you. I just want to give you something." Now, I'll tell you, it's not my building. I'm not an undertaker. I'm not a funeral director. I didn't want to open the door to someone on the outside. So I found a funeral director, someone who I had never met before. And I said, "Someone wants to come in. Why don't we stand here together and open the door?" She opened up the door. It's kind of an experience. It's a wooden door to the outside that's locked by having a chair tilted into the doorknob. She pulls out the chair, she pulls the door, right, and still it sticks, and this little woman shoves $1,000 in cash in her face and says, "This is for the married couple." The funeral director says, "What's your name?" She said, "No names." The funeral director said, "Can I give you a hug?" She said, "No hugs." And she slipped into the dark. The director closed the door, put the chair back where it needed to go. I had never met this woman before, the funeral director. And for 5 minutes, she and I embraced and wept like babies. There is an amazing sense of kindness that comes out after darkness. This is what Nachmanides is saying, that you have to act towards someone with love and with kindness. Do for them what you want for your own family. And that was the first moment in the midst of that horrific week when I began to feel, wait a second, it's not all despair. There is love. There's love of neighbor. There's kindness. And Fred said, "The older I get, the more I seem to be able to appreciate my neighbor, whomever I happen to be with at that moment. Oh, sure, I've always tried to love my neighbor as myself. However, the more experience I've had, the more chances I've had to see the uniqueness of each person, as well as each tree and plant and shell and cloud, the more I find myself delighting every day in the lavish gifts of God, whom I've come to believe is the greatest appreciator of all." We should live our lives knowing that there is love out there for neighbors, knowing that that love is an expression of God in our lives, knowing that we can actually make a difference in people's lives. And so that's what we do at the JCC, at the Center for Loving Kindness and Civic Engagement. We're redefining neighbor from a geographic term to a moral concept. We didn't make it up. We learned it from Rabbi Joachim Prince, who on that fateful day, August 28th, 1963, moments before the Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King took the podium, because of their friendship, because of the message that he was going to deliver. Rabbi Prince, who escaped Germany, said, "In the realm of the spirit, our fathers taught us thousands of years ago that when God created man, he created him as everybody's neighbor. Neighbor is not a geographic term, it is a moral concept. It means our collective responsibility for the preservation of man's dignity and integrity." He came out of those horrors and said, "This is what the world is about. It's about dignity. It's about morality." And tonight, 80 years later, even in the shadow of horrific events, not in our backyard, on our front porch, not just to Jews, but to humanity and to all of us Yinzers, we need to be with him. We need to be with Fred. Because Fred told us that we want to raise our children so that they can take a sense of pleasure in both their own heritage and the diversity of others. And I call this slide Olam Haba. Olam Haba is the traditional way that we talk about the world to come in Judaism. The world to come in Judaism, in Jewish wisdom, has two connotations. One is, after we die, what happens to us? As the Archabbot shared in the liturgy, we believe that our soul lives on. So we have a life after death. I'll be honest with you, us Jews, we're not as concrete as Catholics about it. We don't define it as much as you do, but we know that it exists. And Olam Haba, the world to come, is also a vision of the messianic time, that once the Messiah comes, that eventually we will be in the world to come, a perfected world. And I want to suggest one other interpretation. It's one that I've been living with for years now, and I think we're beginning to actualize it. I don't translate Olam Haba as the world to come. It's the world yet to be. And you know when that begins? Tomorrow morning. My friends, I'm so grateful that St. Vincent's has the wisdom to understand that we need to look back to learn the lessons of history so that we can move forward in morality. And I'm so grateful that in a time of great strife, when others are being demonized, that you would invite me, a kid from Long Island who watched Mr. Rogers growing up and ultimately decided to become a rabbi, to be present with you so that we can prove that there is love your neighbor as yourself right here in southwestern Pennsylvania. I'm very grateful. Thank you.